people ask about when their last Sunday is. They're going to be here at Liberty on Easter Sunday, and that's going to be their last Sunday stateside. They have tickets to leave on April 19th. So time is drawing nigh. You can count that on your fingers and toes, and we'll let Nathan Amber share a little bit on Easter Sunday about their new work. So we're looking forward to visiting with them. We've got several times to visit with them here as that time is approaching. We want to remind you that today we're starting the photography sessions for the church director. And there's sign-up sheets for each of the sessions that we're going to be having today, next Sunday, and the last two Sundays of April. There are some slots available for later this afternoon if you would like to do that, but you would need to sign up as you leave today. And if this afternoon won't work, then you know, please sign up for the other three Sundays and be a part of that. We also want to let you know about a baby shower that's going to be held on April 15th for Hannah and Clint Smith. And you see that information there. It's going to be at 2 p.m. Lower Level Activity Center. That'll be on Saturday, April 15th. And then also out in the foyer, besides the sign-up sheets that we have for the photography session, we're going to be taking our children to Journey Camp. The children had to finish first through sixth grade. It's going to be July 5, 6, and 7. And when I was at the conference in Gatlinburg this past week, I talked to the TBC people that are involved with our Baptist camps. And they said that right now there's plenty of spots. Because I said, well, are we too late? No, you're probably a little early, but you need to go ahead. And they said, we'll leave an alert. The camp personnel will be looking for your registration. So I think it's going to be a great experience. And I'm going. I'm looking forward to it, you know. So that's going to be July 5, 6, and 7. And this will be a very important time of spiritual formation for these children. Now, tomorrow night we have deacons meeting, and also the Baptist women are meeting. And Ms. Flo wants to share a word about their meeting.
Let's pray and praise God for a beautiful day He has given us. Now, tomorrow evening at 7 p.m., the Baptist ladies are having a meeting. Now, remember, ladies, our meetings are open from all ladies from 18 to 100 and beyond. So I want to see some new faces, please, please, please. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Ms. Flo. On Tuesday, we're having our tag luncheon at 12 noon. We invite you to come and join us for that and bring your favorite dish that you like to cook and share with folks. Wednesday night, we're having our business meeting and all of our regular children's activities and for youth. Saturday, we're having a work day at the cemetery, and it's going to start 8:30. It'll be over 11:30, and if you have a weed eater or a lawnmower, it would really help because we're going to try to do the first mowing, if we can, of the cemetery as well as get it cleaned up, and if we have time, we'll try to even put some topsoil in some of the places where there's some little dips and holes where people can turn ankles and et cetera. So please show up, men and women who are strong of heart and body. Okay? Next Sunday, we're going to observe both ordinances, baptism and the Lord's Supper. We're also going to have, in accordance to a vote by the church last year, we're going to have three Sundays each year where we're going to pass the pledge several times for our building fund. So just want you to be prepared for that for next Sunday at the end of our worship service as a way of helping us move forward in our debt reduction. It's good to see you here this morning, and I know that the Lord has so many blessings in store for us. And my prayer is that today that we'll be open to how the Lord is speaking to us as we worship together. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we gather here this morning thankful for this beautiful day. Thankful for the opportunity to meet in this worship center and to know that here we can find peace and strength and encouragement. Forgive us of our sins, Heavenly Father, and the ways that we have failed you. Help us to live a life that will be pleasing to you. Give us the energy and the vision that we need to meet all the challenges that this week is going to have for us. And open our hearts, Heavenly Father, to your word and your love. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus where he multiplied the fish and the loaves. And on the front of the bulletin, there is a picture there of a tile mosaic that is on the floor of the chapel in Israel on the site where this miracle occurred. And I've actually got a replica of that in my office, and it's wonderful to think about how folks many years ago preserved the sites of these miracles and important times in the ministry of Jesus with chapels and worship centers to preserve those places. We're going to talk this morning about God's possibilities. God's possibilities. John chapter 6, starting verse 1. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Then a great multitude followed him, because they saw a sign which he performed on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up on the mountain, and really more like a hillside, and sat there with his disciples. Now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" But this he said to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a lad here who has five barley loaves and two small fish, but what are they among so many?" And Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now, there was much grass in the place, and the men sat down, in number about 5,000, meaning there may have been 10 or even 15,000, counting women and children. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise to the fish, as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the fragments that remain, so that nothing is lost." Therefore they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, which were left over by those who had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, said, "This is truly the prophet who is to come into the world." Let's bow and pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the miracles that you performed while the Lord Jesus was here on earth. And we know you're performing miracles every day. We know that you have not abandoned this earth. You are involved. You're engaged in our world. And Lord, help us to be ever sensitive to what you're doing around us. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Back in the 1890s, there was a Methodist bishop who was at a religious meeting of his denomination. While he was there, he scoffed with his friends, "Men will never fly on their own." And then he told his fellow ministers as he was leaving, "I want to go back home to Ohio and go play with my sons, Orville and Wilbur." So just a few years later, the sons proved their dad wrong. Because Bishop Wright was thinking about the way things were. Orville and Wilbur were thinking about what could be the possibilities. This morning, God wants you to make changes in your life. Could be small changes, could be big changes. Whenever we gather here in worship, it's not about christening the status quo. It is about moving forward in our lives. It is not about waving a magic wand saying everything's You were supposed to, if all possible, go to Jerusalem and celebrate the Passover there. So there, that is why there was such a large multitude there walking along the Sea of Galilee, is because that was a highway to Jerusalem coming from the northern part of Israel. And so there would have been a lot of people traveling and walking this way during this time of the year in spring. So it's not unusual there would have been thousands of people there. So Jesus saw this great multitude. He says to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread that these may eat?" And we're told in verse 6 that Jesus said this to test him. He already knew what he was going to do. Now, so many times we have challenges before us in our lives, and we think there's no way that that'll work. There's no way that'll happen. There's no way that that can change. There's no way I can change. There's no way that I can be different. And what we need to realize is that God has challenges before us in our lives. And what he's wanting us to do is he's wanting to see if we will allow ourselves to be used and yielded for his power and for his glory. Sometimes God does what is illogical to show us how logical it is to be faithful and to trust him. And the story I want to talk about in relation to this, a biblical story, is the story of Gideon. How many here have heard about Gideon? Anyone? Just about everybody? Just to remind you, Gideon was asked to face the Midianite. If you want to go ahead and turn to Judges chapter 7, we can do that. And during this time of the life of the people of Israel, they would go through cycles of serving God, being faithful to God, and then they would kind of fall off the wagon, so to speak. And then the enemies would start to harass them. And then God would bring up a general. That's what we would call them. They call them a judge. But they were a general or a political leader who was also a military leader. And they would deliver the people of Israel from their difficulty. There would be peace, there would be prosperity for a while. And then after that judge would get old or die, then they would go through the cycle of sin again. And it's kind of not only what happened to them, it kind of happens to us too, doesn't it? It's kind of, we get close to God, and then we start to lose that distance, and then we have some tragic mistake, and then we're sorry, and then God has to deliver us. Well, in Judges chapter 7, part of this story is told about Gideon. And notice that as they're getting ready to fight the Midianite, that there are 32,000 people that show up. And then God tells Gideon to say this. I'm going to start verse 2. "The people who are with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into your hand, lest Israel claim glory for herself against me, saying, 'My own hand has saved me.'" So see, what happens sometimes is that God wants to bless us, but he can't, because if he blesses us, we're going to go, "Well, hey, I deserve that. I can't think of anyone better than myself to have received this reward. God must really love me. I must be really doing great, because look how God has blessed me," instead of giving God the glory, right? Isn't that, we fail to give God the glory. So this is what God says. "Now therefore," verse 3, "proclaim in the hearing of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and afraid, let them turn and depart at once from Mount Gilead, and 22,000 of the people returned, and 10,000 remained." And then we know there was then another test about how they drank water from a spring, and that got it down to 300. And with that 300, the Midianite army of thousands was defeated. God had to get that army down to 300 so that then, when they told the story later about their victory against the Midianites, people would say, "Well, how in the world did 300 people defeat an army of thousands?" God. It was God. And probably all those people that left thought, "Well, we're not soldiers like those Midianites. They go around and they raid and they go through and have battle all the time, and they're trained soldiers. years ago, I met a man who had left the pastorate to go into what they call the Volunteer Mission Corps. They still have it here in the Southern Baptist Convention. There are all sorts of positions and jobs on the mission field in the denominational offices all over the United States and the world where there are not funds to actually pay a person to do this, but if people can volunteer, if they have some type of means of support, then they can go and serve. And that's what this man did. I met him in Henderson, Kentucky when he was leading a witnessing seminar, and he was telling us a story that day about how his van needed tires because he was a volunteer. There wasn't much money coming in, right? People would give him gifts and people would help from time to time, but he needed new tires. So one summer he had traveled to the Southern Baptist Convention, and as many of you know, it goes from city to city. It's planned at different parts of the country each year. And while he was there, he received a phone call. And the caller told the minister that a man who wanted to remain anonymous had paid for this pastor to have four brand new tires put on his van, and that this man who owned the tire shop was calling to set up a time where this volunteer could come and get tires put on his van. It was an example of how God was taking care of him. And what we need to realize is that if God tells us to do something, no matter how illogical or irrational it may sound, if we know that's what God wants us to do, we need to obey, and we need to trust that God is going to take care of us. Sometimes we take steps of faith and we're going the whole time with God. Please take care of me. I don't know how this is all going to work. And it will if we're obeying him. He is going to provide. He is going to help us. Alright, so if we go back to John chapter 6, we know that Andrew, one of the other apostles, finds this boy. And this boy, in his innocence and also in his trust, we might say, he had five barley loaves and two small fish. Probably these fish had been salted or pickled in some way to be preserved. And notice a barley loaf. There are different types of grain that are raised or grown in Israel. And if it was wheat, he would have actually been from a fairly rich family, but it was barley. So it was a very basic common grain. So it demonstrates this boy's poverty. And yet, even that, he was willing to share with these thousands of people. Let me tell you something, folks. I've been in third world countries, and the hospitality that I have been shown, knowing how little money these folks have, incredible acts of generosity. I think we Americans could learn something about that hospitality and that sharing and not being so materialistic. Well, I'm sure that probably there were people that saw what this little boy, what Andrew were thinking, and they're probably wondering, man, they're naive. Look at all these people. But what we see here is a very important principle, the power of availability. If we will just say, God, yes, God, I'll do what you want me to do, it unleashes the power of heaven. God respects our freedom so much that if we say no, he respects that. Now, he may keep coming back to us, and he may keep knocking on our heart's door, and he may keep sending people and Bible verses that tell us things that we don't want to hear to keep nudging and challenging us. But the fact is that when we do what God wants to do, we just say, God, I'm available. He will do powerful things in our lives and in the lives of churches and conventions. Well, was thinking about another boy. His name is David. 1 Samuel, if you want to turn with me. And how many of y'all have heard about David and Goliath? How many of you heard about David and Goliath? Okay. Well, we didn't want to go into unfamiliar territory, you know? Okay. All right, so David and Goliath. David's this young boy, shepherd boy. Had a lot of experience dealing with slingshots and spears because he had to protect the sheep from all the predators, the wolves and the bears, etc. Not too many bears in Israel right now except for the zoo, but they had them back in David's time. And look at what King Saul says to David in verse 33, 1 Samuel 17. And Saul said to David, "You're not able to go against the Philistine to fight with him. You are a youth, and he is a man of war from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck and killed it." That's hand-to-hand combat, or maybe it's hand-to-claw combat, isn't it? Well, if you go to the Valley of Elah today, you can see where that battle took place. And I've been there. And remember, when David went out to fight Goliath, he had a slingshot and he had stones. How many stones did he have? Anyone remember? It wasn't one, it wasn't two, it wasn't three, it wasn't four, it wasn't six. Five. Man, y'all are following me here. Now, these rocks do not go back to the time of David, because the Highway Department of Israel goes out and dumps rocks there in that stream every week because tourists like me come and take them. And so the fellow that I was rooming with, when I got these stones, he said, "Why'd you get such big ones?" I said, "Well, you think a little pebble is going to kill a giant? And or kill a bear or a lion or whatever it was that David ever faced?" And then he goes, "You know, it's impossible." You know, he went into the physics of it. I said, "Yeah, exactly." I didn't remember the formula exactly, but I knew it was something like that from ballistics. And it made them a stone like this. These are about the smoothest ones I could find. And I don't think you want any of these to hit you in the forehead at any type of velocity, whether it's slow or fast. Now, don't you know that when David went out there, you know, he went because he trusted God. He went because he did not like the people of Israel being made fun of and ridiculed by these heathen, these pagans. Now, how many people were saying, "Oh, David, man, you can do this"? It wasn't anybody. His brothers were saying, "What are you doing around here, you know, chasing after an army? You're just in the blood and gore and seeing what's going on. Why don't you go back and take care of those sheep?" Yet he's the one who delivered Israel. And let me tell you something. Every single one of us has a giant in our lives that needs to be defeated. Amen? Every single one of us has a giant. Maybe several. Maybe take one on at a time. Okay? Don't take a whole bunch. If you have a dream, if you've got something that God wants you to do, there are going to be very few cheerleaders around, friends. Very few. And the people who are the most negative are the ones who will speak the loudest. We live in a negative world, and unfortunately, a lot of people in churches are negative. And we need to realize that the only way that we're going to defeat the giants in our lives is to trust the Lord, and with courage to go out and to meet those challenges in our lives. And we know that David defeated Goliath because of his faith in God. And God the glory, you see. And it was done for the glory of God. It wasn't for the glory of David. So as we come back to John chapter 6, we see how Jesus told the apostles and everyone to sit down, and he blessed the loaves and the fish, and then he started breaking it. And what happened was, is that everyone was fed. And then John puts in this very important detail at the end of verse 11, as much as they wanted. Okay? So it wasn't like they were eating bread and fish and they said, well, I better not eat anymore because I need to leave something for the other 5,000 people or 5,000 children. But no, they just took whatever they wanted. They were stuffed. And still, after all of that, there was leftovers. I know some people don't like leftovers. You go to our house, sometimes you can't see the fresh food for the leftovers. You know, there's Tupperware containers and all this stuff. What I like about it is you can just zap it in the microwave and then get it out and eat and go home and do whatever you're going to do. So Jesus says, take what remains. There were 12 baskets full. Now, I don't know if they were little baskets or big baskets. Does it really matter how big the basket was? Because look what they started out with, and they ended up with more than what they started with. Which tells us something about God's economy. When you give everything that you have, not just money, but of yourself, to God, you're not going to end up shortchanged, friends. You're going to be more blessed, more excited, and have more than you ever did before. I mean, it is the best investment plan ever. And the dividends are eternal. That's what's great. So, there's enough left over. There's 12 baskets. How many apostles were there? There were how many? 12. One for each one. Hey guys, take this basket home and think about it. And think about how there was probably more in that basket than what they started out with. That's the way God is. So what we need to do is we need to realize that Jesus is the bread of life. He is the one who brings us salvation. He is the one that brings hope to our lives. He's the one that brings direction to our lives. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to call it by me. Jesus is the answer for every question, every problem, every challenge in life. Jesus is the answer. Oh, Pastor, that's just so simple. Yes, it is. That's the way God wants it. We complicate it. Oh, you can't do just this. We're impossibility thinkers. Or we don't make ourselves available, and we forget that God is the source of life. So each disciple walks away with a basket of bread. And let's think about the message that John has for us in his gospel. Let's go to, first of all, chapter 3. Look at verse 2. Here, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, a ruler of the Jews, he comes to Jesus. We're told in verse 2 that he comes by night. And there's a reason for that, because he's going to become a secret disciple. He goes at night because he doesn't want to be seen. And look what happens here. He came to Jesus by night. Rabbi. He addresses him as a teacher. Rabbi. We know that you are a teacher come from God. For no one else can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. So this man recognizes God. This man is from God. God is working here. But when it says that we know this, he knew it in his head, he didn't know it in his heart. It's very important that when we follow Jesus, it's not that we not only know facts about what Jesus did, who he was, about what the Bible says about it, but do we believe? Do we believe and know him as Savior and Lord? Because all his head knowledge will not save you. It is trusting him with your life. And we know that Nicodemus later was willing to do that. Let's look at John chapter 5. Jesus here is speaking after he did this miracle where it was this man who was sick for 38 years, couldn't walk. And then Jesus says, take your pallet and walk. And the man has new life, new health, a new future. And then Jesus says, most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word, hears it, in other words, understands it, and believes in him who sent me, has everlasting life, and shall not come into judgment, but is passed from death to life. The default direction for every human being here on earth is condemnation, judgment, and hell. Because we're born in sin. Yes, even my little innocent granddaughter Reese was born in sin. And she will sometimes do things to kind of manipulate parents and grandparents. And it just happens. And it's a part of human nature. Because we're self-centered. We're thinking about self. We're thinking about what we want. But here is the promise. The promise is that if we turn our lives over to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, if we truly trust him, that we will have the promise of eternal life. And what's good is that in John chapter 10, Jesus tells us, I come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. Does that mean you don't have problems when you're saved? No. You have more problems because now Satan's working against you even harder. Because before you're saved, you're working for Satan. After you get saved, you're on God's side. Satan's going to try to defeat you. Look at the end of chapter 6 of John. Jesus starts to talk about, at the end of this chapter, the fact that he must be killed, that there's sacrifice involved in following him, and we have this great confession that Peter shares. Verse 66, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him. No more. Now, when it's talking about disciples there, it's not talking about the 12. It's talking about the many hundreds of people that would follow Jesus. And they would come and they would listen to him. Here in the United States and in many other countries, if you want to learn from a teacher, you go to a school where the teacher is. But during the time of Jesus, not only in Judaism, but also even in Rome and in Greece, there were many itinerant or traveling teachers. They would go from place to place because the people that wanted to teach maybe could not necessarily come to where they were. Although we know that Plato and Aristotle did have an academy where people would come. But there were most teachers went from place to place to be able to spread their teachings. And so there would be people that would come and go. And so apparently the crowd started to decrease. Kind of reminds us of what happened in Gideon, right? Kind of finding out who's really committed. Who really believes this? Who's willing to make the sacrifice? So some people stopped following Jesus then. Walk with him no more, it says. Oh, what a terrible decision. Then Jesus said to the 12, and how did he say this? Did he say, do you also want to go away? Kind of like pouting? I don't think so. I think he said it maybe like this. Do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. They knew where the truth was. It was in what Jesus was teaching and preaching. They'd seen the miracles. They knew. They understood. Also, Peter says, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Messiah. you trust him with your life? Are you willing to go when others will not go? Are you willing to be different from your friends and from the rest of the world because you trust him? Yesterday I had the privilege to go to a conference where one of our senior International Mission Board staff was sharing a progress report about how God is working in the world. This man was able to travel to Cuba. Now think about that. Cuba. Cuba, a place where communism has been in rule since the early 60s. A place where Christian pastors have been imprisoned, tortured, some even killed. And this man's name is Gordon Fort, F-O-R-T. And Dr. Fort was sharing about how they were touring him through Cuba to see the work amongst the Baptist churches there. And then they said, would you please come, and we're having a meeting of, there's 120 of our Cuban native missionaries who have been evangelizing Cuba. Would you come and talk to them? They need to be challenged. They have done a great job because they have witnessed to a large portion of their population. So Dr. Ford said he would. So he was preaching to them, and he told them, he said, you need to think about how God could use you in other places. What is happening in Cuba with all the hundreds of people coming to Christ, you need to tell this story. And so he challenged them. He said, how many of you, if Cuba would let you go to another country, how many of you are willing to go and to tell people the story of Jesus Christ? And he said what happened was these men, these 120 missionaries, got up on their chairs, friends. They got up on their chairs and they were waving their hands like this and they were saying, I'll go, send me, let me go. I want to be the one to go. I want to be the one to tell people what's happening here. I want to tell them about Jesus. And Dr. Ford said that it was just so emotional to look out on this crowd and they were all on their chairs and they were doing like this. I want to go, let me go, send me, send me. And they had this dedication prayer. And after the service, he said, where will Cuba let you go? They said, well, one of the places they'll let us go is North Korea. Would it help if we went to North Korea? These men who make very little money, they're willing to go. What is God wanting you to do that seems impossible? What is God wanting to do that you need to conquer a giant? All you got to do is say, Lord, I'll go. Lord, use me. It's God's word. Heavenly Father, Lord, you are God. You are God of miracles. You're the creator of the universe. And you want to use us to be a channel of blessing. Heavenly Father, there are millions, billions of people here on earth that do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. But if someone would tell them, they would respond. tell you that when I heard that story yesterday, I cried. Because I thought about how so many people in our churches here in America have all these conditions about how they'll serve God, when they'll serve God. There are people that have called this man up and say, "Oh, Dr. Ford, he's at the International Mission Board. We want to go on a mission trip, but we don't want to have to go get a passport. So why are you calling him? We put all these limits on what God can do in our lives. And God can do miracles when we trust and obey him." And that's what this invitation is about, my friends. If you need to accept Christ as Lord and Savior, when you ask him into your life, you're passing from death into life, from judgment into eternal life. By joining this church, you're saying yes to God. I want to be a part of a great mission force that reaches our community, reaches our state, and